My sermon topic today is divine connections, divine opportunities. Anybody feel like right now you're making a divine connection? Be seated, man. God is blowing my mind right now with the things that he is connecting me to. You can go to a city for one thing and God can do another. In my message, I'm going to tell you what happened to us when we went to Florida. We went for one thing, but God thrust us into the middle of something else that is bigger than both of us. And we are so grateful for it. I want you to understand that 2020 to me was a year of maybe a year of losses. 2021 with the COVID, the pandemic, was a year of lessons. But 2022, I predict, will be the year of favor and the year of blessings. You got to understand that it takes but one person or one moment, one conviction to start a ripple of change. Just as Simon the Cyrene and ask Barabbas, it only takes just one brief moment. It only takes 30 seconds. 30 seconds impacted and influenced and changed Barabbas' life. He had never met Jesus. He wondered in his mind, what could this man have done that would make these people hate him even more than they hate me? His whole life renovated and remodeled when he was just suddenly released and let go. And he hurried down the Via Dolorosa and saw Jesus being taken, carrying his cross up to Calvary. One shining moment changed his life. How many of you understand it only takes just one moment to be changed? Just one moment. Somebody say one moment to be impacted and influenced and altered. In the case of the lame man at the pool of Bethesda in St. John chapter 5, he claimed seniority. He said, like the postal service, like the UPS, Federal Express does a package. He said, I was dropped off here. I was brought here. I was left here 38 years ago. I've been lame and in this condition for 38 years. He says, I'm still here in this deplorable condition because I'm hampered and hobbled physically. And every time I get ready to step down into the water, every time I advance, I even come toward it. Anytime I make an advancement or decide to make an advancement, somebody beats me and steps down in front of me and encumbers and inhibits and interferes. Every time I get ready to be what God wants me to be, somebody steps in front of me and they blocks it from me. Every time, every New Year's service, every altar call, every Wednesday night, every Sunday morning, at every revival and every conference and every crusade, every Bible study, somebody blocks or intercepts or comes in between me and it and hinders me. Someone or somebody impedes or interferes with or slows the progress or blocks me or clogs up the pipes. And for the lack of sympathy and compassion, because compassion is the mother of miracles. How many know it was compassion that drove Jesus to perform miracles and to heal people? The lame man said, for the lack of benevolence, for the lack of a caring friend, I've been stuck, handicapped, stymied, and tied up, handcuffed for 38 years. 38 years late for the party. 38 years always a bridesmaid and never a bride. 38 years a groomsman and never the groom. A professional bridesmaid and a professional groomsman. Always a friend and never a girlfriend. Some of y'all say all the time, I'm always a friend and never the boyfriend. Always the God's father and never the God. Always been a bridesmaid. But how many of you understand that people don't care about the runner-up? Don't nobody care about the runner-up? How many of you know you're handicapped? Not because something that you did, something that you committed. You weren't born blind. You weren't born the way you are. You weren't born like this. You weren't born deaf and dumb. You weren't born suspicious or analytical. You were not born handicapped. You were not born dependent. Somebody made you that way. When you came into life, you were not dependent on other people. You ain't never been the kind of person that was dependent upon other people's benevolence. Something has happened in your life and has caused you to be dependent on the benevolence of others. Nobody, you say nobody is compassionate enough to be conscious of me having my seniority. No man cares for my soul. 38 years ago, somebody brought me here to die. 38 years ago, somebody, my people gave up on me and they left me here and they did this to me. If it wasn't for them, if it wasn't for him, man, if it wasn't for her, if it wasn't for this, if it wasn't for that, I wouldn't be in this condition in the first place. I wouldn't even be here in the first place if they hadn't done what they'd done to me. I am only here, I'm only like this because somebody hurt me. I'm only like this because somebody broke me down. I'm only here in this condition because 38 years I have been dropped. 38 years ago. Somebody say 38 years ago. Y'all have read about Mephibosheth in the Bible. Somebody dropped him. They made him crippled, handicapped, challenged. They made him dependent because of what somebody did. Somebody's sitting in there right now and you're afraid to step out and take a new enterprise, a new adventure because somebody did something to you 38 years ago. You're here right now and you're stuck because of what somebody did or may not have done or said or didn't say 38 years ago. He's stuck on stuck. And there's somebody that I'm preaching to in this place. God may want you to be a business owner. Somebody in here right now has an entrepreneurial spirit in you. Some of y'all ought to open up restaurants. I got some folks right now in the ministry since I've been preaching on this, how God has to bless you to bless the church. God is going to give some of you wealth, not just for personal wealth, so that you can turn around and fund the projects of the house of God. I had a call the other day where we were out of town, even while God was opening doors for us and blessing us in Tampa. We got a phone call in the middle of that and interrupted that, that said the person had got a job opportunity that was going to lead to a business opportunity. They were getting ready to open up a restaurant here in the city of Amarillo. God's putting it all in place. And they said, well, what do we do? And I told them, what you need to do is not admire what God is doing. What you need to do is walk through the doors that God is opening. Come on. You've been asking God to do this all your life. Why are you going to stand around and work for other people? You doing the same thing for other people that you could be doing for yourself. You can't be scared of the blessing of God. You got to step out by faith. Oh, I don't have no faithful people here today. You got to step out on faith. And so right now, they're in the infant stage of opening a restaurant here in town. There's another person sitting in this church right now. I'm going to tell their business. But their hope real soon is to open another restaurant right here in Amarillo. Come on, somebody. Two restaurants sitting in this church, right? And y'all look at somebody and tell them, y'all know we like to eat. Fat as we want to be, big as a butterball. Come on. They're going to make some money because we like to eat. What I'm saying to you is God is leading us on new enterprises and new adventures. Shaka is going to be a policeman. Jacqueline is looking at being a firefighter. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Come on. She came to me that morning and said, have been throwing up all night. She was sick. She's getting ready to take that physical thing. You know, some of the men don't even pass that thing. But Jacqueline's strong. Come on, y'all. And she came by the house and she said, Daddy, I'm sick. I don't know if I can do it today. And I said, girl, please shut that up. You've been doing this stuff you're doing all your life for this day. Now you're going to come in there and hesitate. Ain't no hesitation. Go down there and drag that dummy. I said, go drag that dummy. Go do what you got to do and pass your test. And she said, all right, Daddy, I'm going to do it. Came back later that day, said, Daddy, I was sick, I was tired, but I wouldn't quit, and I did it in record time. Y'all ain't gonna help me in here. Come on, come on. You cannot be afraid to be rich. You cannot be afraid to have money. You cannot be afraid to have wealth. You don't want to live hand to mouth for the rest of your life. It is he that giveth you power Who am I preaching to today? To get wealth. I'm encouraging Elder Williams in his business. I said, well, it may not start out like a house on fire, but if you be faithful and because of how you sold to God, God gonna bless your business. God is blessing Betty's business. Come on, y'all. Y'all see all these businesses? God told me to preach to y'all today. 38 years blaming others for his screws and his nuts and his bolts, his ropes and his chains and clamps and his fetters, his fences and his offenses. 38 years. Always a victim and never the victim. 38 years still making excuses and using alibis why you can't and cannot do something. Jesus asked the lame man, and I'm going to ask y'all today, do you really want to be made whole? Every time I get ready to step down in the water to be healed, somebody or something, his excuse and his alibi steps in front of him. He was letting something that happened 38 years ago keep him crippled and lame and hindered and blocked, impeded. And he let something happen 38 years ago cancel his blessing and prevent his healing and keep him sick, hurt, blamed, cap in hand, handicapped. See, here's the deal about it. You cannot let what happened to you 38 years ago keep you from getting your blessing today. Do not allow your history to destroy your destiny. Here's the problem with us, and I want to talk about it today. You don't get to pick or choose who hurts or betrays or wounds you. We don't get to pick or choose our wounds. We don't get to pick or choose our attackers or our assailants. We don't get to choose our wounds. We don't get to choose or pick who heals us, who picks us up, who encourages us. You don't get to pick or choose your problems, your situation, your circumstance, your situation, your villains. You can't choose your haters. You can't choose your tests, your trials, your enemies, your sickness, your diseases, your handicaps. You cannot choose those who afflict your handicaps or your hindrances. We can't choose that. That's not something that we can choose. You got to ask God to put some folks in your life that will provoke your destiny. You got to get around some people that can encourage you to do what God has called you to do. Loyalty is hard to find, especially in Amarillo. We live in a time now where folks are so disloyal. Loyalty is hard to find. It's hard to find a man that's loyal to a woman. It's hard to find a woman that is loyal just to one man. It's hard to find loyalty today. Trust is easy to lose, but it's hard to find. Action speaks louder than words. That means other people are going to find hope and healing and deliverance and medicine in your womb. In your wounds, people are going to find deliverance in what you've gone through. So you got to inhale your future and exhale your past. You got to funeralize your past. You got to stand over the corpse of your past and pronounce it dead. You got to turn your wounds into wisdom and your difficulties into opportunities. Out of your clutter, find simplicity, and from discord, find harmony. Because right in the middle of your difficulty lies your opportunity. Your position is in your opposition. He who looks outside dreams, but he that looks inside awakes. Somebody touch yourself and say, wake up. You have 206 bones, 650 muscles, and you have 50 billion cells in your body. And I'm telling y'all right now, it's time to wake all of it up. It's time for you to wake. Somebody says it's time for me to wake up. Greater love, people of God, it is time for you to take your rightful position and receive the blessing that God has in store for each and every one of you. Judas was ordained to betray Jesus. That was his purpose. He was ordained to try to stop him. And it wasn't just his idea, it was the plan of God. It was a God idea. See, what you may think is a disappointment, a person that walked away, a friend that betrayed you, a coworker that's trying to make you look bad, you may not like that, but you wouldn't reach your destiny without them. If that stuff had not happened in your life years ago, you wouldn't be sitting where you sit today. Somebody say, my life has been checkerboarded with trouble after trouble, trial after trial. But if you had not went through what you went through, you wouldn't be who you are and where you are today. Can I get somebody to say amen? It's all a part of God's plan to get you to where you're supposed to be. David would only be known as a shepherd boy if it wasn't for Goliath. Some people were bracketed together in the Bible. It's David and Goliath. It ain't just David. It's Mary and Martha. It's Priscilla and Aquila. It's Paul and Silas. It's James and John. See, Goliath was strategically placed in David's path, not to defeat him, not to destroy him, but to promote him, to develop him, to advance him, to elevate and raise and update him. And some of the people that have done the most dirt in your life, some of the most dastardly folk, some of the people that hurt you the most, you can't blame them. You ought to thank them, because God was using them to crowd you to a high level of development. God is using them to promote you. God has not designed or destined you for defeat. He has designed and destined you for victory. How many can say today, I've been set up for victory? Look at somebody and tell them, it's a setup. Everything that I've been through, Satan meant it for evil. But God meant it for my good. Without Goliath, David would have never taken his throne. And without all that opposition and without that, those hurtful days, without those losses in your life, without you going through some enveloped grief, you'll never be able to do, own, or become what God wants you to do, become, or own. There are some owners in this place today. The reason why a lot of churches are able to do things is because they have an entrepreneurial spirit. They are some people of wealth. Now, I'm not telling you that God can't do it, because God can build churches with pocket change. God blessed Elijah on a widow's salary. Y'all ain't listening to me. Everybody has to face their giants. And God is using your giants. I need y'all to talk with me. Say, God is using my giant. Come on, God is using my giant. God is using your giants, your Goliaths, to escort and to usher you to your throne. You were not born handicapped. You weren't born angry. You weren't born mean. You weren't born sullen. You were made handicapped and made angry and made sullen by the things that people have done to you. Goliath was not always a giant. Goliath wasn't always a giant. He was not always 9'6" tall. He was once a baby, just like everybody else. Goliath was cute and cuddly. Y'all don't want to hear what this preacher said. I heard a story about a man who bought a little lion cub, and it was cute and cuddly. He loved it and took care of it. And then one day as he grew up, the little lion cub became a lion, and it was licking his hand. And he had a cut, and it licked the scab off of his hand, got the taste of blood in his mouth. And the lion went crazy on him. Y'all remember a couple of years ago when Siegfried and Roy, that big white tiger, they say he went crazy. I didn't say he didn't go crazy. That tiger went tiger. That's a tiger. That tiger wasn't made to be riding no tricycle. You got a tiger? You didn't talk to he riding a tricycle? That tiger wasn't made. That's against his nature. He's supposed to go crazy when you try to tell him to ride a tricycle. He said, I don't ride tricycles, you fool. And he tore him up. That man had that little lion cub, and it was a cub. It was cute and cuddly. But when it got grown, it licked the scab off his hand, and somebody said it went crazy. No, the lion went lying, and it attacked him. See, your challenge, your special needs, Goliath, wasn't always 6'7". Once it was a baby. With the passing of time, with the care and the attention and training and influence and the nurture of others, that baby Goliath, became a child. And the child became a teenager. And the teenager became a man. And the man turned into a giant. Y'all ain't listening to this old preacher today. See, your cub is going to become a lion one day. So don't complain about your giants, your connections, your enemies. It may look like a setback, but it's really a setup. for God to get you to your throne. There are some people and attachments, some connections that God could not use to promote you. And I do need to tell you that there may be some people in your life that you don't need to have them in your life. Some of you have the wrong connectivity. Some of the people that you're with in their heart, they're sitting at the table and saying, eat, drink, and be merry. But the Bible says the heart ain't with you. There are some people that's in your life, they're smiling in your face. Y'all got it. Y'all ain't been saved all your life. You heard the same song I did. Sometimes God has to remove people from, sometimes God removes people from your life to protect you. Can I get a witness? So don't run after them. Sometimes somebody say they don't like you. And you know, you get your feelings hurt, and now you running behind them, kissing the ground they walk on. If they tell you they don't like you, they call you ugly and funny, Bill. Not going to get no help. They tell you you ain't cute no more, you fair to partly cloudy. Let them go. Let them go. If you can live, I got to say this. If you can live your life and be happy without me, then I can live my life and be happy without you. Y'all ain't gonna say nothing. You know, it just means that they part in your story is over. Sometimes the people you wanted as part of your story are meant to be a chapter. And the problem that we have is don't try to stretch a chapter into a book. I'm not gonna get no help in here. That person comes in your life, that's supposed to be a chapter, but you want them so bad in your life, you try to make them a book. God puts people in your life for a reason, and he removes people from your life for a better and a greater reason. God removes people from your life because he's heard conversations that you didn't hear. God heard some talk. Have every person you talking about, my friend, my boo, my ace coon boo, my partner, that very person, God heard some talk. God was at the meeting. That so-called fellowship that you weren't invited to or wasn't privileged to. God saw things that you couldn't, and so God made moves that you wouldn't. God knows who belongs in your life and who doesn't. Trust God and let him go. Whatever and whoever is meant to be, whatever's meant to be, it will be. There are some people, places, and things, some attractions, attachments, some connectivities and connections, some situations that God could not use to promote you. The fact of the matter is you will never reach your place with that person in your life. And so God said, I can't do it. I can't do it as long as you're with him. I can't do it as long as you're running with her. I can't do it as long as you're over here. If you're at church over here, I ain't going to do it. You got to go where the work. Come on, y'all ain't listening to me. You got to be careful when you start just switching churches, switching visions. You get mad at one place and you just go to another place. You better be careful about you doing that. Sometimes you leave in the barn full of hay. I'm not going to get nobody saying nothing in here. See, God could have used King Saul to promote David. Saul had the authority. He could have moved on Saul's heart and told him to promote that young man, David. But God could have chose to bless David through Saul, not through conventional or orthodox ways. See, here's the thing about God. Sometimes when God gets ready to bless you, it ain't going to even seem right. Sometimes it don't look like it's going to add up. You're going to say in yourself, man, how in the world I'm going to get to do that? I ain't got no education. I sure ain't got no money. My money is funny. My credit won't get it. How is Bishop telling me that God is going to bless me to be an entrepreneur, to own a business, to buy a house, to drive a nicer car, to live in wear a nicer clothes? How can God do that with me? See, God uses unorthodox and unconventional ways to bless you. He did with David. He could have used Saul, moved on Saul's heart to promote him. God chose to bless David through unconventional or unorthodox ways, not through his family, not through his friends. Who am I preaching to today? But through his foes and through his enemies, his opposers, and his infidelity. See, a lot of times your blessing will come through unlikely sources. People that don't even like me have blessed me. I've I've had people who said they didn't like me. I'm in the grocery, I'm at McDonald's, y'all, getting me a hamburger and some fries. And all of a sudden, when I drive up there, they say, "Sir, your meal is paid for." I said, "How?" The folks in the next car, that was the car in front of you, paid for your meal. We were sitting in Leal's one day, me and my wife, just eating and enjoying fellowship, and we got ready to go to pay. This happened to me all the time. Said, "Sir, the lady and the man sitting across in the table over there, they got up and already paid for your meal." There are periods in my life where I can't even buy my own food. I can't even pay for my own meal, because every time I look around, God is using an unorthodox, unconventional, who am I preaching to today, situation to bless me. That's why we don't have the brown nose. Y'all ain't never got to worry about me playing kissy face with folks here in Amarillo and suck up. No, sir. I'm not going to be nobody's flunky. And even out in the streets, folk don't like rat finks. Come on, somebody. I ain't gonna play up to people. I'm not going to go along to get along. I'm not going to try to convince them to like us or to support us or to believe in us or to stay with us. I'm not going to do that. The only things in your life that God will let or allow to die or that God will ask you to kill it or it will kill you are the things that you do not need to accomplish or to fulfill your mission. If it died, you didn't need.